First, you gotta take the oath.
Oh. Okay.
I promise to do everything in my power to protect this city.
I promise to do everything in my power to be a worthy installment in Insomniac Spider-Man universe.
Too soft. He's a low-energy menace. Too easy. Maybe he's a weak-minded... Oh!
Hey, Jonah! Looking good! Very festive!
Menace! A feckless, treacherous, unhinged...
Menace!
Let's go!
Spider-Man Miles Morales is pretty good. I know I'm a little late, but I really, really want to talk about this game. Spider-Man Miles Morales is Insomniac's sort of sequel to 2018's Spider-Man. It feels like more of a really good extended DLC. That's not to say that this game did not have its own unique gameplay or fun experiences, because it did. And I'm happy to say that I had a good time. And so Spider-Man Miles Morales deserves its own discussion. On that note, from here on in, I will be discussing heavy spoilers, so if you don't want to get anything spoiled, please click away now. For those of y'all still with me, let's get into it. This game had a great foundation to build upon. The already great combat and locomotion feels more polished this time around. The web-slinging in particular is something that this game does better than the first, and you felt confident playing as him. Peter's story had been 8 years in the making when we started playing. While I didn't mind it at all, the way Miles moves is awkward and clumsy, but he's just starting out, and he wouldn't move identically to Peter, so it worked for me. But the web-swinging in this game is definitely more refined. The powers that Miles gets differ from Peter's too, his camouflage and venom abilities, which are awesome to use during hand-to-hand combat and stealth missions. New additions like wall takedowns and being able to mark enemies feels like things that Peter should have been able to do. I love how you don't start with all the same moves you acquired the first time around. All I'll say is that if you loved 2018 Spider-Man, you will love this one because you'll be right at home. Beginning the game already knowing how to fight and swing, it's when they start adding new shit like Venom Blast and camouflage abilities where the game starts to feel different. Initially, you feel like you're playing 2018 Spider-Man just with Miles, but as the game progresses, Miles progresses, his abilities progress, his character progresses. With all this progression comes more nuance to the game, making it feel like a worthy installment in Insomniac's Spider-Man universe. The hip-hop influence over this game's score is easily the most unique aspect of it. Instead of expanding orchestra music that played as you started swinging in the first game, here we get hip-hop beats. The Avengers type of music that played in the last game felt right because you were a grown, experienced superhero, but Miles is still a kid in high school, and so hip-hop instrumentation perfectly suits his environment and youthful stage in life, which might take a little getting used to, but as you play, it'll end up really working for you. It did for me, at least. Plus, Miles makes beats, and so did his dad and uncle, so hip-hop is part of Miles' life and family. And as a high school kid in 2020, he'd most likely be jamming to Kid Cudi and Jaden Smith on his headphones. The kind of music makes the game feel fun, unique, and that's important. This game's story is intimate and personal, continuing Miles' story from the first game, where he is in his Genesis stage as Spider-Man. This was a great contrast to the first game, where you were a seasoned vet. Miles is new to Spider-Maning. He's not a perfect web-swinger. He has trouble concealing his identity.
He's young.
If Miles wants to be Spider-Man, he has to earn the respect of the people of his community, who aren't as used to him as they are of Peter. This is a great way to begin the game, where the people, and most likely you, aren't used to Miles in his world. But by the end of the game, the people, and most likely you, will be perfectly content in calling Miles Morales Spider-Man. The situations that Miles deals with force him to make difficult decisions. This is a staple in all great Spider-Man media like Raimi's Spider-Man 2 or Into the Spider-Verse. Even in the first game, Spider-Man having to sacrifice what he wants or fight when he just wants a normal life is what makes Spider-Man so powerful. He makes the hard decisions most of us probably couldn't. He has to fight if needed. If and when the time comes, Miles' life is put aside. This is something that makes being Spider-Man so difficult. Within the first 5 minutes of the game, in the first moment we play as Miles, we are faced with a choice. Help Peter contain a prison convoy or get groceries for Mom. Miles chooses to help Peter. In the same opening mission, Miles has a choice between running away from Rhino or saving Peter. And of course, Miles chooses the latter. Miles earns his spot next to Peter as Spider-Man. This is made clear by many things, but perhaps the most evident is the fact that people came to his aid to conceal Miles' identity and protect him from the unforgiving city. Because Miles helped these people earlier with mundane tasks when they needed it, they help out their hero. However, at the start of this game, we're not here yet. We start this game at the bottom, both as Spider-Man and as Miles. Spider-Man hasn't earned the title of Spider-Man quite yet. He's sort of living in Peter's shadows initially, and Miles is not quite yet the hero he is going to become as Miles Morales, from a boy to a man who understands his responsibility to the world and his place in it. Even in the little things like Miles' inability to sip coffee upside down like Peter, by the end, he can do this. These are small ways to show us how far Miles has come in this short amount of time. By facing much of what Peter dealt with in the previous game, tough decisions, loss, sacrifice, moments of powerlessness, Miles can earn his spot next to Peter. These two can understand each other and the job on a whole new level. The most significant thing both Miles and Peter faced was having clashed with someone close to them, physically and ideologically. For Peter, it was people like Otto, his friend and mentor, or Yuri, his friend on the police force. For Miles, it was his uncle Aaron, aka the Prowler, or his best friend Finn, aka the Tinkerer. Miles treats his situation with Finn like his uncle Aaron would, by lying and deceiving people for his own gain. But in overcoming his uncle physically, Miles realized how wrong he was. Miles makes mistakes, like any hero would. And like Peter, these tough situations force Miles to come into his own as his version of our beloved Webhead, developing his own sense of righteousness. This game removes Peter from the picture at the very beginning, because this is Miles' story. It's the beginning of his journey, discovering who he is, so that Miles can fail and learn, so that Miles can become a hero, so that Miles can become Spider-Man. Spider-Man is meant to appeal to kids and young people because Spider-Man represents heroism at its most vulnerable. Spider-Man is a young kid when he gets his powers. He's 15. Peter Parker must learn what most people won't learn until they're in their mid-20s or early 30s. At 15, Peter has to go up against older, experienced, intelligent criminals. He's scared. He's us. We would be scared too. But fear doesn't stop Spider-Man from running towards a fire. Most of us aren't Spider-Man. Most of us cannot save the city like Spider-Man can. But most of us can help a friend or a neighbor in need when times are tough. Spider-Man teaches us that no matter if you're a 15-year-old kid in high school or a 45-year-old garbage man, you can save someone. Spider-Man represents the best of us, and everyone can learn to be the best of themselves. Spider-Man's story revolves around failing and learning, making mistakes. Heroism is something that people develop as they grow and go through trials and tribulations of their own. It's why Spider-Man's thing is always to get back up when he gets beaten down. In 2018's Spider-Man, Miles was eager to swing around and excited to do his part. And at the onset of this game, he's the same way. But as his story goes on, Miles' life gets more complicated. He finds out that his uncle is a criminal who eventually sells him out, lies to him, and tries to kill him. His friend starts an underground revolution that could easily endanger the lives of Harlem with illegal technology. Miles must attempt to try and understand why they're doing what they're doing. We end the game with Miles emerging triumphant, but getting there took his uncle trying to kill him, ultimately ending up incarcerated, Harlem almost burning to the ground, almost losing his mother, almost having his identity compromised, dying at the hands of a wealthy head of a seedy corporation trying to disenfranchise the people of his community, and most tragically, losing his childhood friend, someone he loved, someone who went from trying to kill Miles to saving his life because of their loving friendship. So when the smoke clears from this game's third act, we end with Miles asking the more seasoned Spider-Man if the job gets any easier. The initially joyful thrill of being Spider-Man at 17 years old is gone. Miles finally realizes what his life is in for being a figure such as Spider-Man. And that's the kicker. Life doesn't get easier. It gets fucking harder. We might find successes here and there, but we're always going to find ourselves knocked to the ground. The question is, do you have the fortitude to get up? The will. Miles isn't giddy and ecstatic at the end, swinging gracefully around the city. Instead, he shares a quiet, intimate, and honest moment with his mentor and his friend. What this tells me is that Miles is now burdened with the reality of not only being Spider-Man, but with the reality of adult life and the hardships that come along with it. This game reduced its scope from the previous game, emphasizing the friendly neighborhood aspect of Spider-Man. The game's main narrative is based around Harlem, whereas in the first game, the main story's missions occurred throughout the entire city. While the Avengers are out saving the universe from an intergalactic threat, becoming almost untouchable celebrities in the eyes of the people, Spider-Man is swinging around the city, thwarting muggers, saving cats from trees. Miles and his friend develop an app to reach out to people in the community, or even swinging to a five-year-old calling out for his idol to give him a high five. Or Miles took the Spider-Man oath. In the first game, he was volunteering at Feast, sacrificing his life to get medicine for sick people, evading the Rhino. He was defending a guy getting mugged. He received a personal lesson in fighting from Spider-Man himself, all before even getting his powers. Miles' character under the mask, like Peter's, is what allows this character to be a hero. The thing that surprised me the most was how much I liked this game. I didn't think that this game would match its predecessor on an emotional level. Peter Parker is my Spider-Man. I grew up with Peter's version of the character. I know more about him than Miles, and I've known him for longer. I was never a Miles fanatic, but this game gave Miles the story that he deserves, one that impressed me. I think 2018 Spider-Man was great, and it taught me many things about integrity and the wonders of Spider-Man. But playing a game of that caliber, but with a younger version of Spider-Man, reminded me of what it takes to work from the bottom up. We started 2018 Spider-Man with Peter already learning many important life lessons, but in this game, we are reminded of those lessons, critical moments in life where we grow the most. Life right now is especially hard for all of us, since we all feel like we're inferior or of little significance. No matter how much we cannot control from life, we can control how we deal with it. And when the right decisions are made, that means something. It means growth and change. Superheroes are manifestations of honor and fortitude. They show us how to save people, not just from physical threats, but from their own struggles or resolve. None of us are Captain America, Iron Man, or the Hulk. We do not have insane abilities, but we all have the ability to do right by ourselves and others. The power to persevere and strive for greatness. Tony Stark sacrificed himself in Endgame because of his devotion to protecting his world. Captain America was only chosen for the Super Soldier experiment because of how good-hearted he was. And if Spider-Man didn't have an Uncle Ben to teach him right from wrong, he'd probably be an asshole swinging around fucking with people, using his powers for selfish reasons. What I'm trying to say is that our humanity actually empowers us all. The grace in our civility, our strength to come together, mankind's strength to forgive, love, and be selfless. We can all do this, and so we are all Spider-Man. There really wasn't much that I didn't like about this game. This game served as a solid appetizer to the main course of Spider-Man 2, which I would have preferred. I think some crucial story beats and character moments could have benefited from more subtlety too. There were a couple of weird edits in a few of the cutscenes, and I experienced some minor glitches. And some character moments were a little cliche and cheesy. The main villain is kind of cheesy. And I will also talk about Peter Parker's new look. And I know this has been widely discussed,
but I think he looks terrible. I hate it.
It is such a superfluous change, and no one asked for it. He looks way too young now. He doesn't look older than Miles anymore. Part of what made the first game special was that Peter was almost a decade into his career as Spider-Man. He looked like a guy who had been through college, written a dissertation to get him a job as an assistant to a well-known scientist, and more importantly, like he knew the ropes. He might as well be in Spider-Man Year One, the way he looks. Oh well.